Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. 19 things that were haram in Saudi Arabia and became halal today, and why they should matter to you. Why is it whatever happens in Saudi Arabia today should matter to every Muslim around the world? In brief, that is where Islam started, in Mecca, and then it moved to Al-Madinah. Back then, it was not known as Saudi Arabia. It was just called Jazirat Al-Arab, the island of the Arabs. But today it is known as Saudi Arabia, and that is how I am going to refer to throughout my talk. I could easily tell you, number one is this, number two is that, number three is this, and number four is that, and finish my talk in 5 minutes, and that's that. But that is not the purpose of my talk. Also, it is not to insult or belittle anyone, but it is rather to give you a tool so that you can interact with anything that you are going to come across in your life as a Muslim. You should never, ever hand your Islam to anyone to tell you what you should and shouldn't do. Even myself, when I speak and when I record my talks here, I am not telling you what you should do. I'm giving you the tools so that you can act responsibly over your own beliefs, so that on Judgment Day, when you meet Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, you should have an evidence as to why you did what you did or why you didn't do what you didn't do. But as a whole, is you do it responsibly. Again, making something that originally is halal and turn it into a haram, and being and having that thing there accepted by millions of people for hundreds of years, takes a lot of guts to get to that point. It takes that people, those who make things haram, have worked hard to reach a status, and also they worked hard at making people believe them when they turn something that is halal into a haram. And in this pep talk here, bi-idhnillah, I will give you the tools so that nobody ever will make fun of you again. Because the story of halal and haram goes a long way. In fact, it goes back all the way to that fateful day when Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala descended our parents, Adam and his wife, from the garden to earth. And before their descent, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala had already prepared the earth, and He prepared it beautifully and purposefully, so that when mankind come to earth, they will find everything that they need to lead a life that initially they should have lived in paradise. But because of what our father did, the mistake, the error that our father did when he ate from the tree, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala sent us on earth, and here we are today on earth to make the best of this earth. It is a very known fact that humans are linked across time. We are connected by a very ancient calling that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala designed for us, all of us. That call is the longing to return to the initial abode, to Jannah. This is what we are doing today on earth, is we are working our way back to that very sanctuary, to that beautiful dwelling that our parents have come out from. Since the very first day on earth, humanity knew of three major realities, and that is what Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala sent with Adam alayhi salam. Unlike what Hollywood would like to portray to you, that man at the beginning used to be like the caves and he used to be, that is not how it is. Adam alayhi salam came educated and everything, and just like any other things, people don't get educated and they behave like animals. But Adam alayhi salam, his wife and their children, they had a good education. But nonetheless, they all knew that they will always need a teacher. And that is why Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, when He told the angels that He was going to create a human being, and then later on He taught Adam the names of all things. Mankind will always need a teacher. For example, let's say your kid is sick and you want to take him to a physician, to a doctor. Who would you want to go to? To a doctor that learned from somebody else who had teacher, or somebody who learned from themselves? everybody would go to the one that had a teacher. Point number two, that time does not stop no matter what. Time doesn't wait for anyone. We have a very limited time on earth, and we should maximize our presence here on earth and do the best of what we can so that we get back to Allah on the best of terms. And the third reality, that is, earth is here for the living on it. When Allah created us and sent us to earth, He didn't send us to become trees or become like some furniture. In fact, He sent us on earth so that we take advantage of everything that earth has to offer that Allah put in it, so that we turn it into something as close or as far as possible to our initial dwelling, Jannah. The Jannah is full of beautiful things, and earth is full of beautiful things too. Of course, there is that huge difference between Jannah and earth, but the truth of the matter is, earth is beautiful, and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has said that earth is beautiful. As for humanity, humanity will always need a teacher. This is very clear in the initial teaching when Allah taught our father Adam the names of all things till eternity and beyond. It is extremely important, my dear sisters and my brothers, to really hold dear to your heart that knowledge and teaching shall never, ever come to an end, and that is regardless of any topic, either religious or worldly sciences. Mankind will continue learning until Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wraps up all the creation and the end of the world comes in. Sadly, a lot of Allah calls for about non-stoppingly seeking knowledge in all matters of life and religion that will help mankind reach the pinnacle of all kinds of sciences, so that they factualize and substantiate that open declaration that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said to the angels, "Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun." I indeed know that which you do not know. The angels never knew that we humans will reach the level of where we are today and beyond. They never knew that. But Allah knew it. And when the angels offered that Allah gives them what He gave to Adam, Allah told them, "Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun." It was part of Allah's bigger plan that humans will exploit their intellect to make this earth a very dedicated and established living place. And to be able to do that, He equipped us with a boundless mind that is only restricted by our imagination. One of the wisdoms that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala commanded the angels to prostrate to our father Adam is, we never actually took time to think of that process. Why would angels put their heads on the floor to a creature, a human being? Yes, they obeyed Allah, but what's beyond that? Well, from my point of view, how I see it is that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala was to show the angels that what humans can accomplish, angels themselves couldn't accomplish because of the difference of the brains we have. Allah has given us the brains. The angels only obey the commands of Allah. If we were to take every human on earth that ever exceeded in anything, from gymnastics to maths to anything that humans do that is a miracle in itself, it's in either the way they move, the way they behave, the way they speak, everything. Let's say we've got someone who speaks 100 languages, someone who is so powerful that they can drag a train, someone that can jump 60 feet up in the sky, someone who can dive in the oceans and can stay there for 30 minutes and not die, someone who can fight lions, someone who is extremely faster than computers, someone. And if we put all those abilities into one human being, that superhuman being, isn't that worth of all respect that we put our heads down for them in complete, total respect for that power that is in them? Well, that is one of the things that the angels showed when they prostrated to our father Adam, is to show that absolute power that this human has, but the angels do not have. That power, yes, the angels can fly, yes, the angels, but at the end of the day, it was given to them. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala gave us the art of flying, but we had to work for it. we had to use everything that Allah has created so that we turn it into something that we can use. Angels fly like that. They didn't work for it. It was given to them. And the example, I hope you get the example of what I'm trying to get to. In other words, what was once impossible, today is very possible. Humans never ever dreamt of having a heart transplant, a face transplant, a limb transplant. They never ever imagined that one day someone would be declared dead, as in a heart attack, and then we have the electric shock and the person comes back to life. That is never ever thought of, like 100 years ago, that was of the impossibilities to happen. And what I've just said here is not some kind of thinking like here or like there. It is beautifully announced and unfolded in the Quran that we don't get back to that often. Allah says, "Allahu alladhi ja'ala lakumul arda qararan." Allah, it is Allah, it is Allah only, who has made the earth a place of settlement to live in. وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً, and heaven, the skies, as a roof over our head. وَصَوَّرَكُمْ, and He architected your image. فَأَحْسَنَ صُوَرَكُمْ, and He beautifully designed your images. وَرَزَقَكُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ, and He provided you with good things. ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ رَبُّكُمْ, that is Allah your Lord. فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ, so blessed be Allah, the Lord of the universes. And this is in Surah Ghafir, that is Surah number 40, and the ayah number 4. Allah created everything for humans. And when Allah created everything for humans, that means everything that is on earth today is halal for us. Unless there is a command in the Quran that prohibits it. Other than that, everything out there is halal. When Allah handed over the earth to mankind, He didn't hand them over a barren, sterile, and unproductive piece of land. In the contrary, the earth came equipped with all that would facilitate life for humans. The air and wind were always present. Today we use them for flying or sailing. It was just mankind 5,000 years ago weren't equipped with the level of knowledge that would enable them back then to fly. But we did. But that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this fact of carrying, the wind carrying people as a miracle, as He gave it to Solomon or Sulaiman alayhi salam. What makes electricity was always on earth. It was just mankind who didn't catch up to it. Even though electricity is a form of an energy and it occurs on Allah's earth willingly and freely. And as such, it was not invented, but rather more discovered. But full good use of it is what we see today. It's very young. Humans didn't have the knowledge back then to understand what would make their lives very easy. Many ayat in the Quran of Allah tabaraka ta'ala praise knowledge in all of its forms. And so do lots of hadith, but I am not going to mention any of them because that's going to make this talk really very, very long forever. But sadly, in the past, our scholars had decided that religious knowledge is what must be taken care of by themselves and further enhanced. Many of them have even considered worldly scientific experiments as haram and did all they could to condemn them, i.e. they took monopoly of knowledge. And they decided back then to decide what was good for us Muslims and what was not good for us Muslims. And I'm going to just give an example here. A scholar that is widely praised and well presented and highly appreciated, and really every scholar out there, at least in Saudi Arabia, sings the praise of this scholar. None others than Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah. And as I said many times, they call him Shaykh al-Islam, and there is no such a title except to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And always, when you hear big titles in front of a scholar's name, it is more than so, is so that you can never ever question this person. So when I tell you Shaykh al-Islam, you're not going to open your mouth, because you will think this is the absolute authority, and as such he is not questionable, when in fact, he is very questionable. And I will just mention a short version of Ibn Taymiyyah prohibiting, not only prohibiting, but rendering a very famous science as haram. Yes, and he speaks here about chemistry. The chemistry that you study in the universities, and that today they make medicines out of it, and they make all those tastes and drinks and everything. In the view of Ibn Taymiyyah, Allah forgive him, he considered that as haram, and that anyone who is doing that is actually committing a sin, a major sin, because that is haram. He said, مَا يَصْنَعُهُ بَنُوا آدَمُ What the children of Adam manufacture of gold, silver, and else types from jewelry and perfumes, and other likes that resembles what Allah creates. Remember once I spoke about escalating arguments, and that is you build one block on top of one, you start with something that is halal, and you start building a block upon a block until you reach the haram. This is exactly what Ibn Taymiyyah is doing here. So look at that, he said, what the children of Adam manufacture of gold, silver, elf, and any other types of jewelry and perfumes, and the other things that resemble what Allah creates, such as their making of diamonds, sapphires, and musk, and amber, and rose water, and the like. So here he mentions a few different things that people were making at his time. And then he said, all of these are not the same as what Allah creates. Until here, we agree with Ibn Taymiyyah. But what he's doing is, he is laying the foundation to lead us to the haram. So here we agree that what they did is not as equal to what Allah creates, and this is very normal. And then he says, it, however, doesn't resemble it. Okay, we agree so far. And then he said, in some form, nor is equal to it. So far, so good. And then he said, either in its amount or reality. And all of that, and then he says, all of that is haram. That is when you make all what you make, as he said at the beginning. And then he said, in the Islamic law, without any difference of argument between the scholars of Islam who are well versed in this. And then he says, and whoever claims that the manufacturer of gold is the same as that created by Allah, his claim is false, both intellectually and religiously. And then he carries on saying, the truth about chemistry is to resemble the creator of creation. That means when people do chemistry, he said that their purpose is to resemble Allah. And this is false intellectually, for Allah does not have any that resembles him, either in his essence, attributes, or actions. And all that was created by chemistry is but to resemble Allah, the creator, and compete with him. And as such, it is haram. And here you see the problem that we got here. Ibn Taymiyyah started from nothing and took chemistry, and he started saying that people use it to resemble or to get the same thing as Allah, and as such, this is haram. And as if what he said wasn't enough, he then turned to a great Muslim scholar, a chemist, a physicist, a mathematician. He was a geographer, astronomer, engineer, and he wrote like endless, around 500 books. Most of them didn't reach us. But this man is well respected in the West, so much so that they used his science in the Renaissance days to get back on the track. And Europe today is far advanced in chemistry, medication, and everything because of the science of this man that Ibn Taymiyyah put down. Today you go anywhere in the Muslim world, the Arab world, especially in the Gulf, and tell them, you take a medicine created in the Arab world or in Europe, all of them will go for Europe. Look at what Ibn Taymiyyah says about Jabir ibn Hayyan. This man died in the year 815 between us and him, about 1,200 years. And then Ibn Taymiyyah says, as for Jabir, the man with the well-spread and famous books on chemistry. What is this man, well-known things? He said, he was unknown, anonymous, and doesn't have any reputation among the people of science, and also is unknown amongst Muslim scholars. And there you have it. Like that, Ibn Taymiyyah makes chemistry haram and attacks a great Muslim scholar who with his experiments shows how chemistry can be good to humans. And again, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah alayhi rahmatullah, a student of Ibn Taymiyyah for 16 years, follows on the footsteps of his sheikh. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah alayhi rahmatullah, who died in the year 1350, between us and him about 670 years, he says, we have proved and evidenced its imperfection, and he's talking here about chemistry, and invalidity from 40 different angles in an independent book. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah wrote an independent book where he provided 40 arguments in which he proves that chemistry is void, vile, and on top of that, that is haram. You see what the problem are? All this can be found in fatwa of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah. The past hasn't died, my dear sisters and my brothers. This is just an example on how science was very much frowned upon. The Ibn Taymiyyah spirit lingers on. And this is what's happening in Saudi Arabia. Ibn Taymiyyah lives on, and everything that they speak about always goes back to make a point value. They always mention Qala Shaykh al-Islam. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah said, and that's that. And as soon as they say that, it becomes, waliyadu billah, just like a Quran. And before heading to the ninth things that are originally halal but were made haram, we need to turn to understand what led to these people making these things haram. And also we need to understand the reason behind. Like a tennis ball that is being hit by two fearsome opponents, while the viewers' heads keep going right, left, right, left, right, left, and if these players do not stop, one day the heads will fall down because they will just break away from the necks. But first, why have some scholars become so powerful, so ambiguous, so disingenuous, and so deceitful? What has given our scholars the power to decide our lives? We can't do anything without going back to the scholars. So much so that in the Muslim world, wherever you go, as soon as you say scholars, every people's thinking goes to religious scholars. But here in the West, wherever you say scholars, people look at you as scholars of what? You need to give them scholars of what? To us Muslims, we only have one scholar that is in Islam. Anything else is not a scholar. Isn't that peculiar? Isn't that extremely strange? And for your information, any scientific advancement that Muslims have witnessed were not from the Salafi perspective. As a matter of fact, a huge percentage of scientists, either science, math, and anything you name it, were of what we call the school of the Mu'tazila. The Mu'tazila are people who put the intellect, and they actually broke away from the grip, the iron grip of the scholars, and decided to use their minds. These people, Abyssinia, Ibn Sina, and all those great people, medical science and all these kind of people, were from the Mu'tazila that we today, not myself, but in Saudi Arabia, they consider them not Muslims. But when it comes to boosting in front of people, we start straight away. Jabir ibn Hayyan was Muslim, Ibn Sina was Muslim, Ibn Rushd was Muslim, and this was Muslim. But when we go to our books, we always classify them as not Muslims. This is the hypocrisy that we live in. The truth of the matter, the reason our scholars became so dominant, so dictator, they dictate our lives, is because we have given them absolute authority over us, and they abused that authority, as it is mentioned in the Quran, and I will get to this point later on, inshallah. Today we are witnessing a very dangerous matter, because the wheel has turned back and Muslim scholars are making, as they have made before and still are making today, the very same mistakes that the synagogue and church made. And if these scholars aren't stopped, they will carry on with their mismanagement and wrongdoings until the end of time. Every Muslim out there knows that at one point or another,
the church was selling places in paradise. People pay money and you get your place, right? Well, our scholars do the same thing. They have put certain things and they say if you do them, you will enter paradise. And people do these things with great hope of entering paradise, as if Allah doesn't have any say in the whole thing. And later on, inshallah, you will understand as to why all this is happening to us. It has become very clear to me that the reason Muslims never saw the beauty of Islam from after the death of our Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, until our times, and if we do not take our Islam from the hands of our priests, also known as Sheikh, then our fate will exactly be the same as those of the past 14 centuries. And that is a great danger. Muslims never ever saw the beauty of Islam for the last 14 centuries. Don't believe the hype of the Islamic State and the Khilafah and all these things. All these are hypes. When you look at history, it's full of blood, murders, and killing. And if we don't do what they didn't do, and that is take our Islam into our hands and put the Quran first, then the next 14 centuries are going to be exactly as the past 14 centuries. The Muslims' misery started as early as 4 days before the death of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only 4 days before he was going to go, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was on a Thursday. Our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was on his bed and he was extremely sick. He wanted to help us Muslims and leave between us something that would save us all the headaches and all the agonies that we are experiencing today. And that what he wanted to do was extremely significant and it's unbelievably significant. And that event took place, but sadly it didn't take place as our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted it to happen. Something happened that prevented him from leaving amongst us something that would save us all the agonies. This event is significantly and exceptionally unspoken of between us, the people of the Sunnah. Yet on the other side, the Shia are making a big fuss out of it. This event is mentioned in every book, hadith, from Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawud, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, and you name it, Musnad Ahmad Ibn Hanbal, and you name it, in all the major books of hadith and the minor ones. This hadith is so authentic that it has come to us from completely different routes, like 50 different narrations. And this hadith is what they call mutawatir, i.e. a group of people attended it, narrated to a group of people, just like Salat, and it is with us today. This event is so important, yet 99% of Muslims are not aware of it, because our scholars do not want to speak about it, because this hadith will not help them in their cause. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, a cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Abbas is the uncle of Rasulullah. Abdullah is the son of the cousin of the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This hadith I'm going to mention here is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, "Yawmul khamis wa ma yawmul khamis?" The day of Thursday, and what a day was that Thursday. Then he wept so much that his tears wetted the pebbles. Sa'id ibn Jubayr, one of the narrators of the hadith that reports from Abdullah ibn Abbas, that he's a tabi'i, he was not a companion, but he came after the age of companions. He said to Abdullah, "Wama yawmul khamis?" So what happened about this Thursday that makes you cry until the way you are and feel the way you feel? Abdullah ibn Abbas qal, "Ishtadda bi rasulillahi waj'a." The illness of Allah's Messenger got severe on that day, on Thursday. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the messenger said, "I'tuni bi katifin aktubu lakum kitaban la tadillu ba'dahu abadan." Fetch me something. In a narration it says the shoulder of an animal. In the other one it's like parchment. In someone a piece of paper. So, but it all is, bring me something that I'm going to write on it. Fetch me something so I can write something after which you will never ever go astray. So this is what Rasulullah wanted to do. He wanted to write something that Muslim if Muslims applied after his death, and that is, it was not something a lot, it was like maybe a couple lines, then Muslims would never ever would have to go through the agony and we would never go astray. But la ilaha illallah, fatanaza'u, the people present at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam differed amongst themselves. Half of these people were from the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ali radiallahu anhu was not there, but there were Al-Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and a few other members of the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the other side, there was Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu and a few other people. So the people differed amongst themselves. And at that time there, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Qumu anni, stand up and leave me alone." And it was not befit that people should defer in the presence of a messenger. And then they said, وَقَالُوا مَا شَأْنُهُ. Umar, it was Umar who said it, but Al-Bukhari, as is always the case for Al-Bukhari, when it comes to a member of the Sahaba, he always, always, always erases the name and hides the name. So tell Bukhari, it becomes he said or they said. But in Muslim, that's why in North Africa and the eastern parts of the Muslim world, they prefer Muslim to Al-Bukhari, because Muslim does not play with the wordings of the hadith. Al-Bukhari plays with the wordings of the hadith. And I will cover this, inshallah, when I speak about the science of hadith and contradictions. And you will see what Al-Bukhari does to the hadith and how he depletes them from so many different meanings. But alhamdulillah, these meanings are present on other hadith. But anyway, here back, it was Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu who said, "Ahajara, is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam just bubbling, speaking out because of the fever, the heart fever?" And that is what Umar said, and that's what made people split into two. And that is when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Leave me, for my present state in what I am in right now is far better than what you call me for." And this is in Al-Bukhari Muslim, and many scholars of Islam, great scholars like Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and Muslim and Al-Qurtubi and all these people, they said, if only Umar ibn al-Khattab didn't speak and there was not a disagreement between the Sahaba, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have written for us a book that we would never ever go astray behind it. But sadly that didn't happen, and here we are today facing all the calamities. What happened on that day is the first adversity that hit us Muslims, again because somebody put their own thinking before that of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is Umar when he spoke, and here we are today paying the consequences and price for that doing. But when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu said what he said, and he created all the havoc and problems there, he gave an argument, and he told the Sahaba, and this is a priceless addition in Sahih al-Bukhari that highlights to us the thinking process of the Sahaba. Umar radiallahu anhu said, "Inna an-nabiyya ghalabahu al-waja." The Prophet is seriously ill, and then he said, "Wa indana kitabullah." And we have the book of Allah. And this is what I wanted to get to. Umar ibn al-Khattab said, the Prophet ﷺ is seriously sick and ill, and we have the book of Allah amongst us, and that is enough for us. The companions radiallahu anhu understood this is why the hadith was not written for at least 100 years later, because the Sahaba always went back to the hadith. And this is when Abdullah ibn Abbas was saying, "Ar-raziyatu wa ma adraka ma raziyatu yawm al-khamis," the calamity, the adversity, the problems that took place on that Thursday. And how would you know what a problem that was? And this is, again, you can go to Al-Bukhari in the chapter about knowledge and you will see a part of it. And it is scattered here and there. And so many people, scholars have spoken about this. So there we have it. 4 days before the messenger's death, it was very much clear and agreed upon between the Sahaba that the Quran was totally enough for them. And for the next 100 years, no hadith was written till the coming of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, who ordered the compilation of al-hadith alayhi rahmatullah. This man was from Banu Umayyah, and he only ruled for about 2 years and 6 months, and he was poisoned because it was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz who stopped the cursing of Ali, and he did so many good things that changed the course of history before him, alayhi rahmatullah. What this also means, my dear sisters and my brothers, and mark this sentence and hold it clear and dear to your heart, the Quran does not allow any human to control us. The Hadith does, and it was used, and it is used, and it will be used to control people. And this is a very sad news. Surah At-Tawbah, and that is the surah number 9, and this is the last surah that was revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In this surah, Allah blows the cover of a variety of different groups: the idolaters, people of the book, Arabs, Quraysh, the companions, and Allah particularly warns Muslims of the man of religion position and power abuse. He warns us in Surah At-Tawbah. This is why in ayah 31, and after Allah speaks of the chief beliefs of the Jews and Christians, the Jews considering Uzair, Ezra, as son of Allah, and Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, as the son of Allah for the Christians. Then Allah reveals where this kind of beliefs that God-son relationship came from. It happened and it came from pagans that existed before the Jews and Christians. Just like we say, you are the son of England, or you are the son of this and that, but it doesn't mean you are genetically the son of that person there, or that car there, or England there. Then Allah shows us who led and spread these beliefs in the children of Israel. And it is then that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts the rabbis and monks or priests onto the scale to look at them from a different angle. It is them who misled the children of Israel, just like our sheikhs today in the matter I'm talking about, the halal and haram, that misled us for over 100 years, where people used to believe that things are haram when in fact they were not haram and they were halal. Look at what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala warns us not to fall in the same trap as the Jews and Christians fell, and here we are today in the same trap as they did. Allah says, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. They took and they undertook their rabbis and their monks as gods besides Allah. And this is again in Surah 9, Ayah 31. How did they do that? How did that happen? Allah further clarifies in the following hadith that happened to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This hadith is authenticated by Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, who classified the hadith as hasan, that is a good hadith. And also At-Tirmidhi alayhi rahmatullah. Originally it's in At-Tirmidhi. But anyway, it's also in Sunan al-Bayhaqi, Al-Tabarani, and other books of hadith. In that book there, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks about Adi ibn Hatim. This man Adi was a man from Quraysh, but he embraced Christianity. Later on, he came to embrace Islam and he came to Al-Madinah. When he came to Al-Madinah, he was wearing a golden cross around his neck. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him, he said in the meaning, Ya Adi, itrah anka hadha al-wathan. Ya Adi, remove this idol from your neck. And then Adi further reports, وَسَمِعْتُهُ يَقْرَأُ فِي سُورَةِ بَرَأَةٍ. And then one day, Adi heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reading the ayah that I read before. And that is, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. They took their rabbis and their monks as gods besides Allah. Adi, when he heard this, and him being a Christian or was a Christian, he said, Ya Rasulullah, we didn't treat them as gods, we didn't worship them. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered back to him in the meaning and the translation, it is not that they worshipped them, but they used to, when they made something haram for them, they would make it haram. And when they make something halal for them, they would make it halal. So what happens is, when the rabbis and monks made something haram, people followed and they treated that thing there as haram. On the other hand, when the rabbi and monks made something halal, people followed, just like we are doing today. When our scholars treat something as haram, guess what? Muslims, we say it's haram. When they turn away and they say it's halal, guess what? Muslims, we say halal. This is how we are worshipping humans. So the scholars become just like the rabbis and monks are to the children of Israel. Our scholars, our sheikhs, our these people that are in men of religion become also our deities that we are worshipping, because again, what they say, we follow. If they say it's halal. If they say it's haram, it is haram. This gloomy dominance didn't fall upon us in one big piece. It was a slow process. It was a build-up from the early days of the very first ever king to control the Muslim crowds by using kingly scholars, i.e. scholars that worked for the kings, that worked to establish the dominance and kingdom of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. It is him who started using the government scholars. Then came the school of thought, another epidemic that plagued the beautiful, undisputed Islam and turned it into a different group. And the Quran was left behind. And instead of using the brain that Allah gave mankind, they insisted and handed it over to the other part of our society, our scholars. Then these scholars, instead of honoring this trust, guess what? They controlled us and they used that and abused the trust that we handed over to them. School of thoughts became an extra piece of identity that Muslims had to carry with them all the time wherever they went. This disease, as I said earlier on, is still up and alive to our darkest days these days. And as if this disease, and I mean the school of thought, wasn't enough to keep animosity alive and kicking between Muslims, comes another layer to reinforce and strengthen this disease, and that is another tool to control us, or a control tool, and that is the hadith. A small portion of it is true and can be linked to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the huge majority of it is made up through the ages. And never ever forget the whole books that Ibn al-Jawzi alayhi rahmatullah, who died in the year 1201, that is between us and him, 8 centuries and 17 years. This man compiled a series of books called al-mawdu'at, i.e. the fabricated hadith. And that will never ever forget the saying of that scholar who said, إِذَا أَعْجَبَنَا شَيْءٍ صَيَّرْنَاهُ حَدِيثٍ. Whenever we liked something, we would turn it into a hadith. And always bear in mind, before those who lied weren't me and you and the general Muslim people. No, these people were people that knew Arabic wholeheartedly. They knew Arabic in and out, because when they fabricate a hadith, the language, the power of the words has to be to the level of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's one. Two, in the early days, before you say the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you needed to mention the whole chain of narrators, starting from you until you get to Rasulullah. So you can imagine a person in the masjid speaking, he would not say Qala al-Bukhari and this. No, he would say X told me, Z told me, B told me, C told me, and until he gets to Rasulullah. So this person had to know the chain of narrators and the man who reports the hadith and everything. Also, these people had a really, really great grasp on eloquence, intelligence. So they were not your regular day-to-day people that made up hadith. These people were professional scholars, people of knowledge, and that is why in the battle between school of thoughts, in the battle between the people of the hadith and the people who use their intellect, whenever somebody liked something, all he had to do is look at the chain of narrators, those people that are highly regarded in the hadith community, and he will tie them together and he will just say that person that said, and the hadith becomes an authentic hadith. That is how today we got the hadith to control us. So I don't like you, then I can make a hadith against you. I don't like you sell bananas, then I will just make up a hadith. X, Y, Z told me from Rasulullah said, do not eat bananas because they call you cancer. Whatever it is, I'm just making up this one here. And it becomes a hadith. And when the scholars come in, they study the chain of narratives. They go, oh, all the people are good. And that becomes a hadith. This is how our scholars today are controlling us, walayyadu billah. And this is also why Allah warned us over and over and over in the Quran and through the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam not to trust those who speak on behalf of Allah, because a human tendency is to abuse their position. This is why Allah uncovered the strategies in the Quran. Yet Muslim scholars did exactly what the rabbis and monks did. And Muslims are living in the same dark ages that Jews and Christians lived under the synagogue and churches in the middle dark ages that Europe and the world went through, and these are well known to everyone. And we Muslims are still living in those dark ages. Let's take a look, my dear sisters and my brothers, on how Allah clearly warned us over and over in the Quran. This is why you understand the Quran is put behind and it's not at the forefront. Because people cannot use the Quran to misguide, to mislead people. Wallahi, they can't. Because the moment they open your mouth, they go, no, it's not that. That's not what they mean. But when they say Rasulullah with the hundreds of thousands of ahadith around us, you can get easily misled. But let's see how Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has warned us, and how the Jews and Christians, when they follow those old rabbis that have turned their religion into what it is today, and the dark abyss that they fell in, and the dark abyss in which we are in today. Our scholars' controlling techniques are mentioned in Al-Quran. Believe it or not, but it is clearly laid down in Al-Quran. The very first step is their oral misguidance. Through eloquence and heavily usage of religious texts, our scholars, they take a text, and then they take it out of context. Like Ibn Taymiyyah, alayhi rahmatullah. Remember when he spoke about chemistry, suddenly he linked to the creation of Allah, and then it's competing with Allah, and then he made it haram. That's exactly what they do. Look at what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says on their gradual process. He says, وَإِنَّ مِنْهُمْ لَفَرِيقًا. And there is some of them, and he's speaking about the Jews and Christians, but also he warns us against anyone who's going to do exactly as they did, and that's our scholars, and we shall see later when I mention those things that they made haram, the evidences that they used, and how today they turned all on top of their heads and made them halal. Allah says, وَإِنَّ مِنْهُمْ, so that Allah does not oppress all of them, he says, some of them, part of them, وَإِنَّ مِنْهُمْ لَفَرِيقًا يَلْوُونَ أَلْسِنَتَهُمْ بِالْكِتَابِ. A team of them, they twist their tongues with the book. لِتَحْسَبُوهُ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, so that you regard it and conceive what they say as part of the book. وَمَا هُوَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, and it certainly is not part of the book. And what this means is a scholar comes to you and starts talking, and he uses terminologies in the book, and he makes it seem like it's from Al-Quran, and you who doesn't have a knowledge about what it is in Al-Quran, you start believing that that is Al-Quran. And then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala tells you that is not part of the book. وَيَقُولُونَ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ, and they say it is, i.e. whatever they are saying, the topic they're discussing, is from Allah. Remember what Ibn Taymiyyah says? It is haram, because that's it. And that is when he says it's haram in Islam, and because they appointed themselves as the outspoken people on behalf of Allah, that means it's Allah who says that chemistry is haram. And then Allah says, وَمَا هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ, and it certainly is not from Allah. وَيَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ, and they relay lies against Allah by using this argument to their end, that it comes from Allah. وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ, and they well know that Allah didn't, it doesn't come from Allah, but it comes from themselves. And that is how they twist reality. So this is the very first thing, oral deception. This is why today when you listen to talks on the internet of Sheikh this, Mufti that, and this, this, and that, you, when you listen to them, you would think that what they say is the Islam that Allah wants. And then they will tell you, it's in Islam, Islam says, when in fact it is from themselves and it doesn't come from Allah. This very ayah is used by a huge number of our scholars, and we will see real example, life example in our days today, and how this vile technique is used. Step 2, dressing up truth with falsehood. To make falsehood look and sound honest and true, and to fully master this technique, our scholars needed to master step 1, and that is oral, and how they turn the argument and make you believe it's from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And by committing this crime, they deserve the denunciation and incrimination by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Because Allah spoke to the people of the book when they dressed up truth with falsehood, our scholars today, they dressed up truth that is something is halal with falsehood by making it haram. Allah says to the people of the book, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, people of the book, لِمَ تَلْبِسُونَ الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ وَتَكْتُمُونَ الْحَقَّ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Why do you dress up truth with falsehood? And you withhold the truth, and you know what you are doing. This is a very clear statement. This is an absolutely clear statement, and people of scholars today, our scholars today, the government employed scholars use that a lot. They dress up truth with falsehood. And the falsehood here is rendering something that is halal initially to haram. By making it haram, they have dressed up the truth that is halal by the falsehood that is haram. The third one is adding human writings to divine ones. They take one ayah from Al-Quran, and what they do to it, they write, and then they take the ayah and write a context for it. And then you would think that the ayah works in that context. For example, yeah, let's say if we are speaking about poison, we're going to say poison is a killer. Now you take this one here, poison is a killer, and you write an article about Coca-Cola, for example, drinking Coca-Cola. And then somewhere deep there, you will enter and you will drive the argument until Coca-Cola in the mind of the reader equals poison. And then you drop poison is killer. And then people will understand that you are saying Coca-Cola is killer. This is exactly what they do with the Quran. They write an argument so much so that when they put the ayah in, the ayah will function with what they have put there. And then they tell you, you see, the meaning of the ayah is what's written there. And that means this is what Allah says, and this is what Islam says. And this is what I said before, it's an escalating argument. This is why Allah warned them from the evil, this very big evil act, and that what they are doing is absolutely so wrong. Allah says, فَوَيْلٌ. Waylun in Quran means adversity, disaster, pain, and every adjective that you can add to this word here. فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ. So adversity, disaster, pain, demolition, and woe, and all this to those who write something down with their own hands. ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. Then they say and claim this is from Allah. لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا. In order for them to purchase with what they have written a small, miserable price. فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِهِمْ. Disaster and curse be for them for what their hands wrote. وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. And may distress and tribulations and agony and everything before them for what they used to win or earn for what they have written. And this one in Surah Al-Baqarah 79, that is Surah number 2, Ayah 79. Again, this curse of writing will be seen later on when we list those mind controllers, the scholars of Saudi Arabia, and how they used the pure, beautiful text of Al-Quran to their own ends. And today, they can't go any longer or any further than what they have done. Now I'd like to cover one last point before attacking the list of those haramized things. And this is about the loose usage of the term haram that's being today used so freely, so irresponsibly, and extremely dangerously by both people of knowledge and the general Muslim population. Anything that you say from Coca-Cola is haram to anything. Anything that they say is haram. So what is the difference between saying something haram and something forbidden? And why we cannot use the term haram freely? A lot of people tend to use the term haram on almost anything that is un-Islamic in their view, from haram Coca-Cola to haram haircut and anything in between and above and beyond. Even though the sole owner of this term has very much warned and threatened about the usage of this only divine right to utter the word haram. In other words, only Allah possesses the sole and absolute right to say what is halal and what is haram. And what he wanted us to see as haram has been mentioned in Al-Quran. anything else, we cannot use the term haram. Any other issue or ruling that this or that, saying that this or that is haram, must bring an evidence, a clear one from the Quran, where Allah says it is haram. For example, if someone asks, can I marry my sister or my mother? We can then peacefully answer, no, it is haram. And why do we say it is haram? Because Allah in Al-Quran says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتُكُمْ وَأَخَوَاتُكُمْ. As in Surah Al-Nisa, that is Surah number 4, the ayah 23. So Allah has made it clear where He says, it's been made haram for you, the marriage of your mother, your sister, and so on and so forth. Because Allah used the term haram, we can use the term haram. For example, just an example, if it says don't park here, the policeman will use the same term park. He's not going to use another term, because what he wants to put the law in action, he's going to use the same wordings as what is out there. And the same thing for us. We only say haram when Allah has said haram. For example, if someone asks again, can I drink wine or vodka? In this instance, we look at what Allah says in the Quran about alcohol. And in this instance here, we will find that alcoholic beverages and drinks are prohibited, but they are not made haram in Al-Quran. What does this mean? This is where people get confused between haram and prohibited. Because Allah didn't say alcohol is haram, we cannot use the term haram. We only use what Allah used in Al-Quran. So what makes haram different from prohibition? Haram is eternal, it is international, and hardly ever changes. Humans cannot change something that is haram. For example, let's take the example of marrying the mother. Is it halal, haram? Everyone can say haram. Worldwide, since the creation of Adam until the end of time, marrying one's mother or sister is haram. End of it. If someone embraces Islam and they come married with their sister, there is no question about this. Straight away, they separate, because that cannot happen because it is haram. If alcohol was haram, then it would have also been eternal and worldwide, like for all humanity. But this is not true. This is why Allah in the Quran uses the term ijtanibuh, keep away from it. Let's say someone embraces Islam and they are alcoholic and they cannot quit, because if they quit, they die. No Muslim scholar in their right mind will tell this person, stop wine, because otherwise you cannot be a Muslim. No, there is nothing like that. We will allow the person to keep drinking, and then we apply the other ayat of the Quran where they don't approach a salat when instead of the drunkenness. So here, as you can see, the haram must stop regardless of what, but elsewhere we will adapt it to whatever is going on at that time there. But to recap, anything that is haram is eternal from Adam till the last man, is for all humanity, and unchangeable, it does not change. Now, someone might say, hang on, Allah has prohibited, He has made the eating of the pork in Al-Quran haram, and you said it doesn't change. Well, you're completely right. But look at the ayah when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرُ. And then He says, except if you are in a state of urgency, you are going to die, then Allah allows us to eat from pork, but it's haram. The reason Allah allows that is because in Al-Quran, Allah has made haram to kill a human without any valid reason, as in Al-Quran mentioned, that when you kill somebody, you get killed. And it is not Allah who prohibits mankind from killing that is going to kill a human being just because of hunger. Because preserving and saving a life is a priority. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, eating pork is haram except when it comes to death. If someone is going to die, Let them eat from that pork to survive until they find real food. And this is how Allah Ta'ala, if Allah said the human will die, then people will say, you tell us not to kill people and you kill them out of hunger because they didn't have a choice over it. So Allah Ta'ala allowed eating pork. He lifted the haram statement for a period of time for that person there because they need to preserve the life, because killing life is haram and Allah is not going to murder somebody just because out of hunger. So based on this, my dear sisters and my brothers, you understand that haram is eternal for all humans, doesn't change. But something that is prohibited can change and can take different positions, as we spoke about wine. For a person who embraces Islam and they are alcoholic, or someone who has gone, for example, a heroin addict. Heroin, once a person gets addicted, it becomes a physical issue. If someone, like if you have a junkie that embraces Islam, we're not going to tell him stop heroin because they're going to die. So we need to find out a way on how this person sadly can continue in there, whatever they are doing, without us killing them and hoping that Allah cure them or whatever they find to cure heroin addiction, things like that. So from here, my sisters and my brothers, you understand that when you utter the term haram, you really need something from Al-Quran, because if you don't do, then on the day of Qiyamah, you are going to face a huge question. And the warning has already been issued. And here it is. This warning exists in Al-Quran and it's already awaiting. It is in Surah An-Nahl. That is the Surah number 16 and the ayah is 116. People mistake and study on the Quran, they write An-Nahl is the bees. But it's not that. An-Nahl is a ni'am, is what Allah gives us. In Surah An-Nahl, Allah mentions lots of the gifts. Even the Mufassirin, they call it Surah An-Ni'am. An-Halahu Shay is when you give something to somebody. So Surah An-Nahl is what Allah has nahalana, what He has given to us, but not the bees. But anyway, the bees were called An-Nahl because they take flowers and they give us honey. So they named them with the fact of the gift. But anyway, in this surah, Allah says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبُ. And do not say to what your tongues falsely describe, هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ. This is halal and this is haram. And as a result for that, لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبُ. So that you forge lies against Allah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبُ. Those who forge lies against Allah shall never ever succeed. And this is the state of our scholars. Basically, what Allah says here is pretty simple. Do not twist your tongues in issuing statements on things by saying, this is halal, that is haram. The television is haram, cars are halal. So Allah Ta'ala says, do not twist your tongues, you have no authority. Look, my dear sisters, my brothers, to understand this, you have to look at the issue from a different angle. If someone comes into your home, they have to follow your rules. What you say correct is correct, and what you say is not correct is not correct. If you walk into somebody's house and you find that this person puts vases of flowers on their chairs and they treat the chairs as vase support, you cannot tell them, use the chairs for sit on them, because this is their house, they do what they want. And to Allah is the highest example. This is the land of Allah. It is Him who created it. It is Allah's belongings and it is Him who did what He did. Isn't that His right to decide what is halal and what is haram? It is His sole and absolute right. So when anyone takes that right away from Allah and puts their nose where it doesn't belong and changes something that Allah said it is halal and they make it haram, haven't they played a god? They have. Just like someone who walks into your home and starts dictating the laws in your home. Aren't they behaving like the owner of the house? They are. So anyone who issues the statement of Coca-Cola is haram are actually appointing themselves as a God who decides that Coca-Cola, even though Allah says it's halal, they turned it into a haram issue, and on the Day of Judgment, they will answer to Allah because Allah has warned. And do not say to what your tongues falsely describe, this is halal and this is haram. By that, they force lies on Allah. I can see now it's an hour, so I want to stop here and get to the second part, inshallah, when we start with the 19th things that were haram and the arguments they used and how they used different arguments to make them halal. And this is a great calamity that we are experiencing. Again, until part two comes, inshallah, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. To be part of my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp on 078-76-40-87-35, or just go on YouTube and go to Islam Pep Talk, and you, inshallah, you get this talk and around 200 other talks. I pray to Allah to give us the strength, and inshallah, off to part two. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.